Well, guys, here we go. This is the start of the Cape York trip. We've offloaded the trailer and this mobile Sheraton, and now it's just down to Dennis and I and the little Susies. We've got them all packed up, heaps of space in there. We're going to head off this morning down to Battle Camp Road, which we're told is pretty rough, but we'll see how far we get. And then off up into the Cape. I'll try and do a daily one, just so we can have a bit of a record of what we did and where we went. All right, guys, and here's the second mad one of the party. All ready to go, looking a bit clean and tidy. He's not swearing for a change.
Got me
which,
food.
Which makes a huge difference. He's not actually swearing. What about 20 k's out of Cooktown, and I think this is the last time we're going to see bitumen for a while. The road seems pretty good at the start of it, but they tell me now we can look forward to some corrugations. I also think this is really where reality is set in, and I've now realised I'm living the dream once again. I'm off to the Cape. Thought about this for many, many years, but looks like I'm doing it.
30 k's in, and already we've got our first water crossing.
Okay, found the first issue. The first water crossing we went through, the beautiful nudge bar on the front just stopped me stone cold dead and pushed it straight back into the bumper. Looks like it's lost me about 6 or 7 inches of ground clearance, so I'll just have to take it steady. We've managed to pull it back off the bumper and it's looking alright, so yeah, all part of the adventure, eh?
Okay, so now we're getting battered around, so we've decided to let the tyres down to give us an extra set of shock absorbers, because it's just rattling everything to bits. These corrugations are horrible.
That was one of the smoother sections.
It's a bit of breakaway country now. These corrugations, man. They reckon there's 10 million of them on the way up to the Cape. I think we've done about 300,000 already. We're down to about 15 k's an hour. That's about as quick as we can get along here. We've let the tyres down, but she's still pretty rattle and roll. And we got Dennis coming up behind us. I don't know if you can see him there. He's taking it nice and easy. Want to come back on the same shock absorbers as we left with, but something tells me it's going to be a slow
trip. We've got a station here on our left hand side, Normanby station. It's been around for a long, long time, I think. Oh, a little weather check too. She's 36 degrees outside and 43 degrees inside the cabin, so hot and sweaty, but having fun. Okay, guys, we've spent the last 40 kilometres doing about 10 or 15 k's an hour on these corrugations. It's a real good test for the little Susies, and for my teeth, I've got to tell you. I don't know if you can see up front there, but we've got a fairly large fire broke out, so we're not sure whether we're going to have a change of plan yet. We seem to be heading straight into the fire front, but as and when we get closer, we'll see what we're going to do. Another cattle grid, another set of corrugations.
Stopped for a lunch break out at the Lake Emma Camp Falls. We got some strange lighting at the moment with the bushfire. We just had a yarn with the with the ranger who pulled up, and Nico, where we left our the Sheraton and the little TARDIS camper, had already warned us that these two feral blokes in Suzukis were heading up there. So he's keeping his eye on us. All right, we've had a bite to eat now. We're going to get back onto the corrugations and do probably about another 60, 70 k's, and then we might call it quits for the night.
Letting Dennis do the Hugo first. At least the corrugations have backed off a little bit now. We can kind of hold us
steady 50, 60 k's an hour, might be able to make up a bit more time. Water crossing we've got to get through here. She's pretty dry. Dennis has found the right way through. Oh, a bit sandy and boggy on the way out. Going you, Dan. As you can see, the river's pretty dry. During the wet, this would be just a big torrent of water.
Just thought I'd show you this, it's amazing. We've just crossed the Laura River, and within about 500 metres, you're into real tropical rainforest again after coming out of the scrub. Lots of palms. A lot more jungle. Oh, and a little old truck. One that didn't quite make it all the way up to the cape.
As you can see now, the road's changed once again. We're now on basically pure sand and bull dust. At least it doesn't rattle you around as much, but it's there's some big holes in the middle of there. You'd be cruising along just quite happily and all of a sudden, woofer. It's like hitting water and it's just dust. I'll switch this off because I need to concentrate where I'm going.
Coming along to the 12 mile water hole. A little termite mound. The sun's starting to go down a little bit. It's about 20 to 4. We may be starting to look for a camp very soon, I think. We'll see what the big.
Okay, we've gone from corrugations to what seems like ancient pavement. Laid by the Romans with toffee hammers. At least it's a bit better than the corrugations, but it's still rough.
Okay, this is a couple of the hazards that you face coming along the road. We have a lot of one-way old wooden bridges, which at the moment, large bolts sticking up in the middle there. Are over pretty dry creeks. I really don't want to stop too long on this bridge.
Here comes Dennis, arriving at camp. We're going to stay at a little place called Catfish Campsite. We're about the middle of the national park at the moment. It's been a fairly rugged day. And I'll let you know when we set up camp. Hello, Dennis. Okay. Swag's up already. Got the mozzie net over there. Dennis assures me there's going to be millions and millions of sandflies and mozzies. There's also warnings of crocs around the place, but you know the beach dweller. He just likes to stay next to water. So this is my little vista. I'll try and not fall on my ass as I'm going down here. They tell me there's freshwater and saltwater crocs around here, but I reckon the bank's a bit steep for them to climb up, so I'm going to give it a go. Not that I'll be going swimming in here, of course, but still not a bad place to camp. $5 a night, there's nothing here except Dennis and I. And hopefully, now we're going to have a look at the mini Sheraton.
How's that look?
Look at this, this is Hollywood. Dennis assures me that the one he's bought is sandfly proof. So it could be me that's getting bitten during the night. Looks pretty Hollywood. Only took him about 2.5 hours to put up, but it's all right. It's looking good.
Well, morning, we just knocked down camp.
Sorry, that's Dennis just coming through on the two-way. We just knocked down camp. It's about 20 past seven. It was a bit interesting last night. I had the mozzie net over the swag. But I ended up getting cane toads and all sorts of frogs climbing all over me for most of the night. So it was a little bit interesting, but still a good night's snooze. I got up at dawn this morning, had a good breakfast. We're about 214 k's away from Cowan now, which is our next stop, and we've got some fairly rough roads to get there. The old TomTom tells me it's going to take me 5 hours to do that 200 odd k's, doing it slowly. There's a large bump there. So no doubt I'll be checking in during the day. I thought this might be a good time just to share with you some of the remoteness out here. It's only 25 to 9 and it's about 30, 33, 34 degrees and getting hotter. The humidity is about 110. we've just come down a set of corrugated section of road there. It doesn't look that much now, but if you look at the distance between the corrugations, you basically can't hit these any faster than about 5Ks an hour. It is just shaking the vehicle to bits. And it's been like this for the last 10Ks. And you know the real sad part about it? I reckon it keeps on going for another 10Ks. Dennis left me about 10 minutes ago and you can just see him in the distance. He's probably got half a kilometre in front of me. Out here as well, you'll see there's lots of these, what used to be known as magnetic termite mounds. It was thought at one point that the all the mounds actually faced to magnetic north. Well, they've done a bit more research on them now and found out that these little termites are actually smarter than what you think. And what they do is that the narrowest part of the termite mound actually faces north to south, which means that they get the sun across them when it rises and sets. Keeps them nice and warm. All right. Back to the corrugations. Catch you soon. Ciao. Man, this is hot. Just off for a little break, let Dennis catch up. We're in the middle of a remote plain on the, I suppose, the southern tip of the Cape. Man, it's hot. There's nothing out here. This is interesting country. You wouldn't want to be stuck out here for a while, I'll tell you. There is nothing. I see Dennis coming in the distance, see his dust arriving. Have a little bit of a break and then back to the pounding. Boy, these cars are getting a pounding today. I imagined that the road through the national park would be fairly rough, but this is just unbelievable. I've never been pounded. We've been on the road now for probably 3 hours, and I think we've covered about 50k, 60k. It's horrendous. But oh well, all the fun of the adventure. And here comes little Whitey coming down the track. Hear the squeaks before you see him coming. She's gathering a few rattles, the old Whitey. But he'll get their fans a roaring. All right, we'll catch you on the next
one. Okay, we made it out of the worst of it. We've arrived at Musgrove Station Roadhouse. So it's about 100 k's to Cone. The last 30, 35 k's coming out when we turned at Annie River was just like four lane highway. Some pretty bad corrugations and stuff on there. This is one of our little mates here.
There you go.
Yeah, mate, there's people arriving here that haven't even got dust on the cars. So obviously coming up the long way round is the easy way round. But anyway, having a bit of a break here and we'll catch up with you soon.
Okay, I reckon this is the real road to Cape York. It's about the width of the four lane highway. We've just stopped off at Cone and yeah, good place to stop off and keep going. $1.50 for fuel. We're heading up towards Archer River now and then we'll probably camp there for the night. But these are the roads that I expected to be travelling on most of the time on the way up to the Cape. Fortunately, not too bad on the corrugations. We can sit on about 80 k's an hour, so the journey should be pretty good.
Hey guys, we're on the development road heading towards Cone. We're about 55 k's out. This is a bit more like a freeway. There's a massive difference in the condition of the roads. They've just started grading it too, so it looks like we can make some decent time up here. We're in a bit of a convoy now. We've arrived at Archer River, our camp for tonight. 60 k's up the road. Got a bit of shelter under some trees, got some nice little rocks that I can sit on. Get in tune with earth. And here's Dennis putting up the mobile Sheraton.
He reckons it's white man's magic the way these poles go together. It's quite scary. Watch the stealth way he does it. You think he'd been doing it for a week. It's all in the crossover, Dennis. It's all in the crossover, mate.
That's the way it goes. Well, I've done it once before.
No, you're not allowed to swear, the video camera's on. It's all against the clock. Oh, now he's into the final stretch. Look at this. Like a total pro. And I think the technical name for that is pear-shaped. Oh, now he's broken the pole. There we go, look at that. Ah. Well done, Mike.
Okay, start of day three. We've knocked down camp at Archer River and we're heading out to Lockhart River, which is about 155 k's. It's on the east coast of the Cape, about 300-400 k's from the top. We've got another plan for later. We've let the tyres down. I've dropped the fronts down to about 20 pounds. And the backs are about 22, and now basically sitting at 60 k's an hour, 70 k's an hour on the corrugations and rocking along quite nicely. According to the TomTom, the 145 k's is going to take us about 5 hours, so we could have an interesting run into Lockhart River. Catch you during the day. Okay, we're on the road to Lockhart River. We've done one river crossing up to now. She's actually a lot smoother than I thought. There's a fair amount of roadworks in here, but there's some crackers and dips. You're driving along and then just all of a sudden the road just woofer, just disappears down. I reckon there'd be fairly deep torrents of water during the wet season. There's a lot of burning through here, a lot of the looks like they've either been doing back burning or something like that. And she's not as hot today. Ah, here's your daily fact for the day. I don't know if I've told you this already, but the Cape York Peninsula is the same size as England, or the same size as Victoria. It has a total population of 14,000 people. Of which 12,000 are indigenous and 2,000 are whites. So there's not a great deal of people up here. Although the ones that are up here seem to be okay. There's the odd empty cart and a grog sitting alongside riverbanks and things, but The community we're in now is both alcohol and drug free. Let's hope we can keep it that way. So this is your guided tour of the road to Lockhart River. It's called Portland Road. If things check out all right, we should be staying around the area, I think, for a couple of 3 days. There's a bit to do there, a bit of fishing and a bit of having a lounge around on beaches and things. So we'll see how we go. The corner, I think we've got another water hazard which has got to be crossed. We'll see how deep it is. Oh, geez, a bit of bull dust coming down here. Yep. All right, we'll get Den to go. Hugo first.
Off you go, Mike. I'll follow you through.
You're going to hear me. You're going to have a try.
Yeah.
Maybe coming through.
Yeah. All right. Can I get round you on the left-hand side or right-hand side? Come back a bit, mate, so I can get past you. Okay, so Dennis wants me to get his feet wet first. And then I can video him coming across. Way of washing the tyres off. And here's Dennis coming across. See if he's going to show off and get a bow wave going. Yeah, he's showing off, get the bow wave going. That's so me to break. Good on you, Dennis. Nearly got
one
me.
One thing we should mention too at this point is both of these little Suzukis are absolutely stock standard. There is no modifications being done, no suspension mods, nothing. They're straight out the showroom. I've basically bolted a set of spotlights and a nudge bar on the front of mine and a tow bar to tow my little trailer. But standard tyres, all we've done is let pressures down. So it's a good testament. The things are carrying a fair bit of weight in the back too, and they're just bowling along these roads. Another bit of water to get across. We're really getting out into the remote bits of Lockhart now.
It's a bit rough at the bottom. There we go. Good as gold. Jesus.
Okay, we've got down into the rainforest now, not far away from Lockard, but we've come across a slight hazard. Looks like we've had a truck that's managed to bust itself going through the water splash. Dennis is just going to go off now and have a little look, see if there's a chance we can actually get round it or not. Otherwise, we could be here for a while. A little look down the West Claude River. As you can see, we've got right back into rainforest territory now. And we're just sitting here waiting to see where this is.
Okay, this is the road heading out towards Chilli Beach and Portland Road. You can see now that we're back into real rainforest country. Roads are a lot narrower. Just hope we don't meet any road trains coming down this bit. They're obviously doing a bit of work around here. We went down and saw Lockard River Mission, which is basically an Aboriginal community, and sorry guys, didn't bother taking any video. They're sad places, they really are. Anyway, off to Chilli Beach. They tell me it's a tropical paradise. I hope so, because I'm a bit dusty and hot, ready for a sit down and maybe even a glass of shardy.
Okay, it's 3:15. Been a long, dusty day. Went in to Lockhart River and we found our way out to Chilli Beach. This is real rainforest type area. And I'll just take you on a little guided tour of the vista that we've got here. It's pretty spectacular, actually. Weren't quite sure what to expect here. Lots of people rave about it. And you get here and it really is the tropical paradise. You've got the coconut trees, coconut palms out on the beach. Perfect white sand. Some islands out there. This is about high water mark. So it means that we don't have to stroll too far to get in the water. A couple of the guys that were camped alongside us last night at Archie River have arrived here. There you go. Well worth the trip. Even if it was a bit hot and dusty, it's good to be here at Chilli Beach. Coming back from the beach, we're about 80 metres, I suppose, from the edge of the water. Come straight back into rainforest. We've got ourselves a nice little camp spot here. Dennis will be putting up his mini Sheraton, no doubt. Pretty big area. I suppose you could get a lot more in here, but we kind of blocked it off. Just keep it to ourselves. Got your own tables and benches and stuff. And I've already got my little setup ready to go. Here's a little Susie a rest for the night. She's worked hard today. The road in here was absolutely brilliant. It was just undulations over kind of sand dune type roads and just allowed you to really have a bit of a go and wonderful drive. And the odd water crossing, all thrown into the day. Welcome to another sunny day in paradise. We've taken the short drive out from Chile Beach down to Portland Road. This was the site of a Captain Cook came in to the inner reef after repairing his ship in the Endeavour River and was glad to get shelter out of the reef again. Also, it was the main jetty when they were building the wall, World War II base in the Coral Sea War. The Americans, there's about 22,000 Americans in this area during that time, and a very camouflaged camp in amongst the jungles. Spoke to a couple of locals last night. They were telling us about all the hippies that used to live at Chile Beach and the alternative types. They've all since been cleared out and it's become national park. Also, as well, out of interest, we found out about Restoration Island, which the photographs and the video I took yesterday is on the left-hand side of the camp, and it's actually the first land that Captain Bligh made after the mutiny of the Bounty out in Hawaii. So it was the first land they'd seen after crossing the Pacific. So a pretty historical little place. They tell me now that half the island's national park and half is normal land, and there's a pretty senile old bloke lives out on the on one half of the island. There's actually fresh water out on the island. He doesn't like too many visitors, I don't think. Maybe it's a plan that I could work on for the future, find myself an island. All right, so this is the little view from out here. As you can see, there's a couple of charter boats, and there's probably about 150 people, if that, live here now. There is a cafe here, quite a world-famous cafe. Cooks up some good food, and people travel from all over the world to stay at Chile Beach and have a bit of a dine at the cafe. So just give you a bit of an idea of Lockhart Mission. This is the Aboriginal camp, the mission. She's a pretty sad place. I'll find my way back out of here now. This is all a bit confusing. I think I found it. This is all government run. They're basically self-sufficient, I believe. They've got their own council offices and stuff here. Generator sets. But not a place that's a happy place at all. Okay, we come back out of the Lockhart River Road, and we've decided to try a little goat track, which should knock about 60-70 k's off our round trip back up towards the Morton telegraph station. It hasn't been too bad going at the moment. She's pretty narrow and rutted, but there's the odd wash away. I'm just going to place the video on the dashboard and let you have a look at the goat track. Denny seems to have flown ahead for some reason, obviously on a mission. I suppose it's a concern. My only thought coming down here is we have to at some point pass cross over the Pasco River. I've no idea how deep it is, what the crossing's like, whatever, but anyway, we shall see when we arrive. Now, there was a track went off to the right there. I'm hoping that I went down the right one. Can't see Dennis anywhere, so who knows? Foggy sand. Still haven't used four-wheel drive yet, but I think I'm about to select it very soon. It's amazing where these things will go in two-wheel drive. Thought about it in four-wheel drive yet. I'll just call up Dennis and just see if he's how far he is. How far in front are you, Den? We'll wash away here. Better take a time down this.
idea here is you've got to try and cross the deepest ridges with keeping your wheels on the high spot so you don't bottom out. This is real Cape country. This is the bits that other people just don't see. Alright, well obviously Dennis has flown well ahead because I can't see any dust, a sight and the sound of him. So we'll just take our time coming down here and taking the ambiance. Not much ambiance on that one. Okay, choices. We'll go around that way, I think. Ah, here's the Denars here. Okay. It says backtrack there, so I think we may have arrived at a bit of a dead end, I think. Anyway, we'll see. Okay, the consensus was we avoid the station, we keep on going downhill. Let's see where we're getting to. It's getting a bit bouncy now, guys. Decent test, knocking rock and roll inside the beauty. Oh man, some big bumps. Okay, well, we seem to be able to rock and roll through here. Walking nicely up the hill. Great thing with these little Susies too is you've got electronic four-wheel drive, so just when it starts to get a bit boggy, you can just flick a button on the dashboard and she locks into four-wheel drive, and as soon as you're out of it, press the two-wheel drive and you're back on rear-wheel drive. How easy is that? Car yard on the left hand side here. Looks like this. Looks like there's a fair amount of gear being abandoned here at some point. Looks like there's somebody's humpy in there too. Yeah, we're down into somebody's station here, I'm sure. I'll just flick the video off. Okay, we made it through the water splash just. Bit of a crunch underneath. I think Dan got it on video. And now we're in, very average country. But I don't think there's too much turning back because that was a fairly steep exit out of the water crossing. And I don't really fancy heading back down there again, but this is getting pretty average, boys. Somewhere in the middle of the Cape. I suppose it'd be all right if you were 50 or 100 k's away from suburbia, but I don't want to be breaking anything out here. As you'll notice too, I can't get rid of the cough. I think it's all the dust I'm around. Okay, track's starting to open up again a little bit now. See, she's been pretty well burnt out through here. Hopefully we've got about another 10-15 k's of this, and then we should be back out into the main development road and heading up towards the telegraph station. I need to stop and have some lunch soon too, because that's, oh, it's 1:30. So we've been in here for 1.5 hours already, and we've probably done 20 k's. Oh, that was a big termite mound in the middle of the road. Missed him now. Could have made it plunk. I better back off from Dennis a little bit, I think, actually, because just in case he spots something like that large rock there. Walk him round. Keep it on the high side. Good girl. Also, for a little 1.3, I mean, she's pulling up and around here in second gear two-wheel drive. And you can basically get it right down to idle and just feather the throttle, and it gets torque from nowhere. It just pulls it up and just keeps on going. Oh, dust, Dennis. Okay, we've got to go over a log here, I think. Yeah. Just slowly walk over the top of this little sucker. Yeah. Well, you can't say this is not an adventure, guys. This is all a bit not what I'd expected of coming up the Cape. Well, I suppose it is. This is probably what I was expecting about coming up the Cape. I never thought I'd really get the chance to do it, though. This, to me, is the getting out really into the four-wheel drive country. The track that most people use to cut across to take a shortcut is called Frenchman's Track. But that's got a fairly steep entry and exit too into the Pasco River, which we just crossed, and they closed it a few weeks ago for that reason. I'm going to knock this video off now because I've just seen Dennis bouncing up and down, so it looks like there could be something fairly big I've got to go around here. Although, hang on now, we might be able to do it. Yeah, we're just going to walk over a log, that's all there is. You got a tree right in the middle of the road. We'll just over the top of it. There we go. There. Is there nowhere these little things won't go? Another telegraph pole. Oosh-a. Yep. She's not too well used, this track, I don't think. Now, there we go. Might just hit four-wheel drive for this and just walk her up there slowly. First gear, low range, and just let her walk up. Good, there we go. I hope this gives you a bit of an insight of the adventures of the beach dweller. What we get up to, and what I get up to. When Dennis is around, what he gets up to. If you remember on the first trip, there was always the theory you never turn back. Well, I think it's happening on this trip as well. Alright, I knocked the video off, obviously. The cough's starting to get to me, and I better concentrate a bit more. More to come.
Okay, this is the last creek crossing, I believe, in the last 35-40 k's we've done. Boy, I am absolutely busted.
I've probably experienced the hardest four-wheel driving I've ever done in my life, and it's just been constant for the last 35 Ks. Just no let up. Just roads like this. They're just big deep river crossings and just big washaways. Poor old Susie's taking a battering today along with his driver, I'm afraid. I'll actually be glad just to get back onto normal gazetted roads. Cough's not getting any better either. Alright, till later.
Okay, first stop for the day, we stopped at Bramwell Junction, Bramwell Roadhouse. This is actually the start of the old Telegraph Road. We've actually decided not to attack it. We were sort of speaking to some guys this morning. My body's pretty busted, and I really don't want another day of flat out four-wheel driving, so we're going to cruise around the bypass road, as they say it's pretty rough. Didn't get much sleep last night. Got the swag down, had ants running through it, and bugs dropping on me, but hey, it's okay. About 2 o'clock I managed to get a couple hours sleep, got up this morning, and we're ready to continue the adventure. We'll just see how we go from here.
We're about 50 k's away from the Jardine River now, and you can see the countryside's changed completely. We're basically on a mixture of sand and sandhill type roads, which then turn back to red gravel corrugation. We were thinking today was going to get a little bit easier, but some of the corrugations we've experienced since we left Bramwell Roadhouse has just been horrendous. I haven't been doing too much videoing. We've had places where we could sit at 60, 70, 80 k's an hour, and other places where we've been once again back down to 5, 6, 7 kilometres an hour. We met a guy that we talked to for a while in Cooktown, and we met him on the way out of when he was coming out of lockout and we were going in, and he reckons that he did Archer River to the Cape from 9 o'clock in the morning through 2:30 in the afternoon. Like, the roads we're going on today, you couldn't do it 2 days from Archer River, but obviously he's got a spaceship or something, but never mind. The debate is now whether he actually ever got to the Cape or not. Once we get to Jardine River, we've got the $88 return ferry crossing, and then we shouldn't be too long then before we get to Bamaga, which is going to be an overnight stay, and we're a matter of a couple of k's away from the Cape. So yeah, the challenge is nearly there. Had a bit of a corned beef sarnie for lunch at the end of some roadworks, and we're back to the corrugations, so I'll say ciao for now.
Okay, what a bit of an adrenaline buzz that was. I've just been sitting on a straight bit of gravel road of about 15-20 k's on 120 k's an hour. Boy, were we flying. All right, we've arrived at the Jardine River Ferry. This is your $88 return, cable ferry. We've paid our money. It also entitles us to bush camping the other side and access to a couple of fishing spots as well. These boys seem to do it pretty casually. Yeah, that was definitely an adrenaline buzz to sit on that sort of gravel with bull dust, but I just had to do it. These things we have to do. And the little Suzuki just flew along. She was honking. She was just giving it flat out. Okay.
Hello, mate. How are you? Not bad for $88 to take you about, where are we going? About 20 metres. Yeah, I'll be back. Still, pays your money, you get your choice. This is the closer to the cape. I think now we're about 40 k's or 30 k's away from Bagara. This is going to be our overnight stay. And then tomorrow is the big day. We'll head out and actually walk right to the tip. And we've made it. I'll catch you on the other side of the river.
Well, we've made it to the most northerly town in Australia. We haven't actually made it to the Cape. It's 20 past six. Another battering day on corrugations. She was pretty hard going there. Although we only did about 200 k's, the body's feeling a little bit more knocked around. Just had a shower, got myself all spruced up, and about to head down now for a feed down at the lodge. Got ourselves a top camping spot here. We're actually right on the beach, on Loyalty Beach. Managed to wash all the dust out. And this is the sunset that's sitting over paradise. We're going to stay here for about 7 or 8 days, I think. We just decided that, what the heck, might as well take in Thursday Island, Horn Island, get out into the Torres Strait, have a good look around the place. But she's a pretty special camp. If I just whiz around here quickly, you'll see, coming from the beach, there's the little Susies. So she's pretty good. I enjoyed my trip today. It's a little bit easier going than the last couple of days. Those bloody corrugations, though. Even though they say there's 10 million, I reckon we've done 20 million. The little cars have stood up really well. They've done the job. Nothing's fallen off. Nothing's broken. Bits of the iPod adapter have fallen off, and my GPS adapter's fallen off, but at the end of the day, we've got here, guys, we've got to the top of the Cape. We've got to the town. We're 34 k's away from the actual Cape, so we'll do that over the next couple of days. And no doubt you'll get a mugshot when we're sitting right at the point of the top of Australia. I'm going to go get a feed.
Okay, it's blowing like a banshee. And we're about 20 metres away from the tip. Strange, actually, after all this time. 18 months. I've been to the most extreme parts of this paddock. Sea Point in West Australia, Byron Bay in New South Wales being the west and eastern points, Cockle Bay down in Tasmania, which is the most southern part, and now I'm just about to arrive at the tip of Cape York. It's been a punishing trip, but I tell you, it's one of those things you got to do. Even the road in today was 30 odd k's of just horrible gravel and corrugations. Now I'll try not to get dumped with a big wave when I get out here, but you never know your luck. Looks a bit damp out here. Okay, we can officially say you are at the most northerly point of the Australian continent. Somebody's left a number plate here. So there you go, guys. We've made it. Hope you enjoyed the little video journey we've done. I'll update the blog as well at the same time. And I'll put this out to a few mates and friends. There's a bit of a record of a trip from Cooktown up to the most northerly point of Cape York. Thanks for sharing it with us. It's been great fun. And what we're going to do? Hold in reverse and go back.
me inside you like a lover sleeping silently. A children by the time they're three, that northern serendipity, we'll take you by surprise. You're sitting at a waterhole, the dry season's just arrived, the shimmer of the waterfall, the movement of the crocodile. Track, and you're broken down, and you're walking back, and the thunder's building, and the lightning cracks, and you wonder if you ever get home. But don't despair, you'll get there. You'll be dying at first, but you'll get there, and you will feel the joy to the northern air. And you'll get back to camp, and you'll crack a beer, cause you can get it, go and walk about, get it, just hanging out. You can get it with a coral trail. Matter of fact, I got it now. You can get it in the territory, you can get it in the Kimberley, you can get it in the Coral Sea. And I do believe that I got it now.
See?
play. And we'll go, all of them, my friend. See it.